So good. Well, everything you wanted to know about prisons. There should be a question mark there, I guess, because there's lots of things about prisons I'm not going to talk about. And first of all, I want to know, you know, when you go to a talk from a visitor, you just go to see, well, this is an interesting area, don't know anything about it. Anybody here have a keen interest in prisons and what they do? Okay. So here's a handout for afterwards, because much of what I'm going to speak about today is in a couple of Xeroxes of a book chapter. And in the last topic, there's also a Xerox of a recent paper. So for those of you who are specializing in the area, you're welcome to take one of the handouts. There's only five here, but you can get them Xerox. Okay, so I'll just slide around here. If we can go to the first overhead. The thing I'm going to try to do, for those of you who are not expert in the area or don't read about it a great deal, is to give you a context. And I'm going to talk about three of the major theories of prison life, the data that's been generated testing these theories, and the policy implications of these three theories. And so after I do that, hopefully you'll know what is the topography of the land in regard to prisons and what people think they can do, should do, and so on. Then I'm going to talk about an issue that is of particular interest, because I started working in prisons, I hate to admit this, back in 1961 in Kingston Penitentiary. And one of the issues, and I've worked in prisons off and on for quite a bit of my career besides being an academic, is can we manage prisons in a safe and humane fashion, and can we protect the public? Now, in a safe and humane fashion, I'm talking about having prisons that treat offenders decently, as it were, are not run in a way that there's always riots and disturbances and that and so on and so forth. And the issue of protecting the public means when people leave prisons, can we do something about reducing their recidivism? And so I'm going to be talking about all kinds of research in that area. And the final thing I'm going to talk about are extreme conditions of confinement. And I think I'm quite liberal in a lot of my attitudes in regard to the socio-political context, but when I present some of this information, some of you people may be upset, depending on your ideological leanings and what you think about prisons, and what you may think about extreme conditions of confinement, like solitary confinement and administrative segregation. All right, so let's start on our journey, and we'll talk about theories of prison life. The first one is the deterrence theory, generally. And we could just have the whole slide presented. What we have here, then, are a number of factors in regard to the deterrence theory. The deterrence theory argues that the goal of prisons is to reduce criminal behavior by making them a punishing environment. And this kind of policy is, of course, resonates throughout the United States in many jurisdictions. And we live in North Carolina for at least half the year, and I've been in the United States many, many times over the years in my professional work, so the deterrence model is alive and well in various parts of the US. And in addition, the deterrence model is now becoming alive and well in Canada, is it not? With the Harper government's emphasis, and in regard to the kind of policies that Vic Taves is promoting, Jeffrey Simpson, the famous pundit for the Globe and Mail, says we now should refer to Correctional Services Canada as Punishment Canada, because they are embarking on some of these policies. Now, it's a fascinating theory, really. And the punishing stimuli that people in this camp argue for, what are the punishing stimuli are, if you go to prison, you'll be stigmatized. And you don't want to be stigmatized, do you? You'll be labeled an offender, an inmate. You could lose your income, and of course that could be punishing. And it can be a dehumanizing kind of environment. That is, the pains of imprisonment, the assumption that being in prison causes all kinds of psychological pains. And so these are the three major ways the deterrence philosophy argues that prisons can be effective in suppressing criminal behavior once the offenders are released. Now, this kind of rationale is based on a kind of econometric model. If we were to take a look at professions, what profession, often in their past, has argued that a simple cost-benefit equation can suffice in reducing criminal behavior? Psychologists? Not likely. Criminologists? A few, but not very many. It's the profession of economics. And they argue in the way they present their policy formulations, never mind whether it deals with offenders, is that the offender, in this case the offender, is an individual who will, going through prison, will come to some kind of cost-benefit equation as to whether the stigmatization, the loss of income, or the dehumanizing environment they live in was all worth it. And they'll make it in the same kind of way you'd make a decision if you were to purchase, say, an automobile for a certain price, and you'd take a look at various sorts of prices. The economic rational cost-benefit equation. Now, this theory also has had some moderators. One, by some economists, argue that, well, it is only really the low-risk offender that may be deterred by stigmatization or loss of income because they have the most to lose. Another way they argue, and it's an interesting way, they almost argue like they're psychopharmacologists. Okay. That is, and I've been asked this a number of times, Dr. Gendreau, what is the precise dosage of time you must serve in prison for the punishment of the prison to kick in? Lots of years, a few years, shock incarceration, a few days, okay? So, just think, I'm not too sure anybody here has a strong psych background, but if you take a look at the psychopharmacological research, where people, in doing the research, taking a look at what kind of drug or what dosage of drug will influence the behavior of the organism, whether it be an infrahuman or the human species, would say, well, a certain amount of milligrams of this drug will produce the behavior change I want. So the economists argue from this rational cost-benefit equation that if we could only find the precise dosage of the amount of time served, that will serve to reduce criminal behavior once the offender leaves. So are we fairly clear on that? Any questions, don't hesitate to ask. But it's a way of thinking that is often foreign to at least how we psychologists and many criminologists would think. So, next. There are a number of issues in regard to the deterrence model. One is scientific credibility. Who here has a lot of psychology in their background? There's a few. Who here have taken learning courses and on the effects of punishment and how punishment works? A few, eh? Often it's not taught anymore, by the way, because the issues have been decided many, many years ago. So when we talk about going to prison and the offender is losing their income or being stigmatized or feeling the pains of incarceration, does that sound scientifically credible to you as a punisher? 2 cents worth, anybody? Come on, folks, don't be shy. Okay. By the way, if you're dealing in the public arena with policymakers and with politicians, they would probably think that stigmatization and losing income is a real punisher. Think of how psychologists think about punishment. Who are the experts in punishing people in the behavioral arena? They are experimental learning psychologists, I'm one of them, and or a behavior modifier who deals with punishing human behavior. And in the psychological literature, it's very clear as to what the punishing stimuli are that can reliably suppress behavior. Anybody like to nominate a few, if you can remember anything about your learning courses or in psychology? Sure. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. That's right. There are 12 conditions. Okay? It's much more complex. In the deterrence literature, they never talk about that. They've never even gotten to first base in that regard. But in the experimental learning literature and the behavior modification literature, there are up to 12 conditions that must be rigorously followed. And your professor named three of them. Another is, for example, you can't escape the punishing situation and others. But what about punishing stimuli? What in psychology, through behavior modification work and research work done with animals, has been shown to be effective punishing stimuli? Pain? Yes. How? Deliberate how? Electric shock. Ton of studies. And I'll make some more. Response cost is one. That's fine in the layman's language. Immediate fines. Also, any kind of aversive stimuli, such as highly aversive smoke or highly aversive things like scolene, a drug which paralyzes the respiratory system. Now, all of this may sound rather Orwellian and strange to you, but psychologists have done their job over the years in carefully delineating what kind of things punish, what kind of stimuli punish, if they follow a number of the kind of operational considerations that your professor mentioned. So deterrence, really, if you look at it from another perspective, from another social science, does not have much scientific credibility. Okay. Another one is prisons are too soft. Interesting argument. One of the leading economists in the area argued, well, stigmatization works in punishing offenders. But damn it, the incarceration rates are so high in the US that stigmatization doesn't work because everybody seems to go to prison sometime or other. Now, you want to make light of that, but if you take a look at incarceration rates of African-American males in the U.S., fully one-third of American African-Americans born from, is it 1990, fully one-third will have done time in a prison. And so the stigmatization folks would say, well, it's a great idea, but it's not probably not going to work because, hey, you go to prison, that's not stigmatizing. Yeah, I know lots of other people who've been to prison and so on and so forth. This is within the American context. Now, the reaction to this is, well, damn it, we got to make prisons tougher. Okay? So how do we do that? Well, there's been a major movement in the U.S., and it's now, you can see it in some of the things that Vic Taves says in Canada, is that we should have no-frills prisons. That's been a big movement in the U.S. No visits, limited access to your lawyer. Maybe that's a good thing, I don't know. The things like no education, no recreation, no free health care. Okay? The argument by some in the U.S. is that, hey, I don't have free education. You know, it's tough for me to find health care. Why are inmates getting that? So we should make prisons tougher. Secondly, to make them even tougher, we should bring back corporal punishment, which is in prisons would be the whip. All right. By the way, there's not many benefits of getting old. In the case of people like myself, in trepidation, you worry about what your next blood test will be. But I do remember some things that are sort of interesting, and I remember working in prisons when the whip was used. And you could hear the lash, and you could hear the howls throughout the prison. And the view would be, not only does that punish the offender getting whipped, but it'll be a general deterrent for the rest of the inmates who'll say, oh my God, I don't want to do anything bad in this prison. Look what's going to happen to me. Actually, we have data on that. And when I get back to North Carolina, we'll be writing that up as to the effectiveness of the whip in our prisons, at least in one prison where we have lots of information. So prisons are too soft. We've got to ramp it up by no frills and bringing back corporal punishment. Then there are the simple-minded assumptions, and this goes back to the previous overhead, we don't need to go back to it, is that, you know, the offender is sitting there in prison, and he's saying, oh, I'm running through this calculus like I'm purchasing a can of beans in a store. dear, this is a punishing experience. No, I don't want to do this anymore when I get released. There is the assumption that if you have an attitude, say that you've been punished in prison and you don't want to commit crimes again, that that attitude will correlate 100% with behavior. It's the rational crime model. It's the rational econometric model of thinking about crime. So tell me about this, from those who've had your psychology courses. What area of psychology has researched this literature to death? Don't be shy, folks. Social psychology, okay? A huge database over the years. As a matter of fact, what is the average correlation between having an attitude and that will be witnessed in your behavior? All of you have attitudes about all kinds of things. Eh? I'm going to lose weight. I'm too fat. It's not good for my health. It's a strongly held attitude. Well, ever notice any difficulty in transforming that attitude into an actual behavior? And all kinds of other things in our lives. The average correlation between having an attitude and the subsequent behavior is about 0.3. Now that is useful because we have cognitive behavior therapy and it's all on the premise that if we work with a person's attitudes, then we'll see a change in behavior. Okay. As a matter of fact, when you take a look at the data of an attitude leading to a behavior, you'll get correlations ranging from 0.08 in some areas to as high maybe as 0.5. I'm not denying that looking at attitudes is not important, and then an attitude can lead to a behavior change. But there is a tremendous amount of slippage in that area, and social psychologists have examined in detail all the kinds of necessary conditions that go right in here to see or have as much as possible the attitude leads to a behavior. So that is another real problem with a deterrence view that has this simple-minded kind of thing, that I've been stigmatized in prison and God, it's painful being here, I don't like it, I'm going to straighten up and fly right when I release. Well, isn't it surprising if you take into account this literature that there should be lots of false positives? Offender traits. This whole deterrence model never takes into account who offenders are. Would you nominate for me, just for discussion, any traits of offenders that might be antithetical to having a simple attitude equals behavior 100% correlation? Some of the characteristics of delinquents. En anglais, s'il vous plaît? Oh, it's psychopaths? Right. Sure. Narcissistic. Views that it won't happen to, it'll happen to somebody else, but it won't happen to me. That sort of thing. Frequently under the influence of a substance. Does that help you think clearly? Immediate gratification. Offenders, generally the highest risk ones for certain, have a whole host, a whole gestalt of attitudes, values, and beliefs that would make them really impervious to being receptive to the threat of a punishment. Okay? As a matter of fact, if you are into the psychopathy area, you would argue that there's a genetic component to particularly high-risk offenders that would prevent them from responding very well to punishment. Okay. So these are some of the issues that the deterrence theory doesn't even bother talking about, but because they don't read the literature or they live in their own little bubble in terms of promoting their theory. Next overhead. What is the data? We've been involved in this in generating meta-analysis. By the way, does anybody here do meta-analysis? Really? Well, it's a useful technique because when I talk about the stuff I'm talking about today, it's almost all based on meta-analysis. I rarely resort to a primary study because there's so little information in them. It doesn't mean you have to do them. Because you get enough of them, then you can do a meta-analysis. Well, there are a number of meta-analyses. There's five major ones that have come out in the literature in the last several years showing that inmates who go to prison versus stay in the community and get a sanction, which is called parole or probation or something, inmates who spend varying lengths of time in prison, this is one of ours, all in these two cases, the evidence indicates, and by the way, they are controlled for in terms of risk level. I mean, they're approximate controls. It's a quasi-experimental design. I mean, there's two or three random assignment studies where people were sent to prison and ones left in the community that are done many, many years ago. But all of this data indicates that going to prison or serving a longer sentence length increases recidivism by 2, 3, 4, 5%, maybe 7% in some cases. You may say, well, that's a trivial effect. But when you take a look at the medical literature and some psychological literature, you can find that slight increases in recidivism can have huge cost-benefit problems. Take, for example, the usual medical research, it's Canadian data, taking aspirin for a stroke, prevent strokes. The correlation between taking an aspirin and preventing strokes is about 0.02. Oh, you'd say, that's a trivial effect. But if you take a look at all the potential strokes in males and the taking of aspirin to prevent strokes, that has huge cost-benefit implications in medical practice. And so we'd make the same argument here. There is another aspect of data just now showing up a bit, not many studies, is that harsher prison regimes. There have been comparisons of offenders in harsher prison regimes, you know, more harsh versus less harsh. The problem here is that these studies define harsh as security level, and because there's more security level versus less security level doesn't mean the prison might be have more no frills or have corporal punishment and the like. But in any case, the data indicates that inmates, and you're trying to control for risk in these studies, harsher prison regimes lead to a slight increase in recidivism. We have been involved in searching for moderators. Maybe there's some aspect in all of this data. By the way, these databases are not small. In the research that we do in this area, our sample size is 260,000. Okay. So I think we can generalize some of these results. And when we look for moderators, we can't find any. Juveniles versus adults, males versus females, the quality of the research design, and on, we can find no data like from cutting these moderators out in the meta-analysis to show a deterrent effect. Next. Let's have the whole thing if we could. Now we're going to talk about schools of crime. Now, this is something I'm sure you all have an opinion on. This is something I'm sure you know something about. And the schools of crime is very traditional in criminology. And it came and was first presented by Donald Clemmer way back in 1940. And then Gresham Sykes used to talk about this kind of work in terms of the pains of imprisonment. And this general view has it that there's a culture in a prison of antisocial attitudes and behaviors that reinforces criminal behavior. That is, what prisons are graduate schools of learning about crime. And the view by the people who supported the prisonization view within criminology was that everybody is affected. There has also been revivification of strain theory, Robert Agnew, Colvin, and the like, about the kinds of factors that could occur in a prison to increase criminal behavior. Then, of course, there's differential association. I love the theory as a psychologist because differential association, as developed by Sutherland and then changed around by Akers, is straight operant conditioning. Okay. And then there is, if you're a psychologist, straightforward old Bandurian social learning kinds of stuff. And if you're interested in the psychological perspective in this, there's a beautiful article by Buxtel and Kilman in Psych Bulletin in 1980 that really says it very, very well. And all these theories, even though they have different orientations, all support the view that, you know, going to prison is a school of crime. Now, if we can have the next overhead, please. What are some of the issues in the schools of crime view? Well, criminologists don't do much work in this anymore. It's an interesting kind of thing when you take a look at the history of ideas in a discipline. Criminologists, when they presented this theory, when they had this theory come out back in around the 1940s, were pretty sure that they had a gold mine here, that in fact going to prison was a school of crime and it was a universal powerful effect. In actual fact, when you take a look at the research, because it was done many years ago, that it hasn't borne out in the way that criminologists would like. And many criminologists have just abandoned the field. It's rare to find one working in the area. Psychologists used to be involved in the area, and people like Haney and Zimbardo would argue that, you know, where are psychologists involved in looking at the gut level things that are going on in prison? Because schools of crime is looking at what's going on in the prison and how it inculcates criminal behavior. And psychologists who used to be involved in developing treatment programs, who used to be involved in looking at what goes on in prison and helping manage prisons, abandon the area. Of course, you know what psychologists are like. They love a disease. So they love psychopathy, or they'll love some kind of other disease. Or psychologists can be like crows with colored beads. And the next colored bead, and they'll all rush to it and do the work. So if you think I'm a bit hostile towards criminologists a little bit, it's partly my age, I get grumpy about everything, but also it applies to psychologists. And so there are very few people involved in looking at these issues. But that has now changed a little bit. There is one school of criminology in all of the U.S. which is interested in looking at this in detail, and that is at the University of Cincinnati, where I have lots of contacts. And there is the Canadian School of Psychology, who still gets involved in looking at these things. The data, or what the data seems to indicate, even though the prisonization prediction is that this is a universal effect across offenders, no matter what kind of prison you're in, and so on and so forth, there now seems to be evidence that the low-risk offenders may be, in fact, the victimized by being in a school of crime. And I'll talk about some of the data in that regard. There's also the, not here on this overhead, but people are now doing some victimization work, looking at victimization in prisons and whether that leads to psychological upset upon release or leads to higher recidivism. As my colleague Shelley Listwan is probably the leader in the area at the University of North Carolina. So there is some data to indicate that there are schools of crime, but it may be in the low-risk area. Next. Now we have a theory nobody likes. This is a spoil sport theory. Hey, if you are making a movie, and I used to have a course, I'd talk about how the movie is portrayed in the media through film, and it's taught by Paula Smith at the University of Cincinnati. And of course, if you want to have a movie that sells, you don't want to have a movie where nothing happens. I mean, you want people to be upset, be outraged, be acting out. That'll make a great movie. And if you've ever seen a movie about prisons, Shawshank Redemption and a number of others, there's always some drama going on. Well, what if you had a theory that says, no, forget about it. Prisons are mundane environments. Okay? And where does this theory come from? It came from an interesting criminologist called Charles Thomas, way back in the 70s. And he said, now wait a minute here. What you see in prison is likely a bunch of behaviors imported into the prison, which was held by the offender long before they ever got there. So if you see disruptive behavior in prison, is the prison causing that? Is that a psychological pain? Is that a school of crime? No. The person who is a very difficult person in prison is likely extremely difficult, acting out psychopathic, goodness knows what else, before they ever got there. The prison is a relatively neutral environment. Then, this theory was taken up years later by two Canadian psychologists. Has anybody here heard of the work of Frank Porporino or Ed Zamble? Yeah, well, you're at Queens. Yes. And they argued that they're interested in how offenders coped in prison. And by and large, the coping you'd see in prison, whether it was good or bad, was imported in there. And they have recourse to the coping literature by Lazarus and a number of others in the psychological area. The issues when people deal with this is that you can always find exceptions. And you can go into any prison and always find someone who is an exception. And you can often try to use that to prove the rule. And then there's a view that risk level. Interestingly, Zamble argues that it's people who cope worse may be higher risk, although it's not too clear exactly how he means who are the worst people. There are some people who cope badly with prison, and you could argue maybe they're the higher risk offenders, but maybe you could argue otherwise. Well, before we get to the next overhead, what do you think the data is for this importation model? Make a guess. What do you think? Do you think this importation model has a hat to hang on? Anybody else? Of course, how many people here have worked in prisons extensively? Yeah, they're okay. So it's easy for, I can understand where you're coming from. If you've never worked in a prison, you're influenced by media accounts and exceptional stories, what we call in social psychology the availability heuristic, where you can think of extreme examples and then that becomes a generalizable fact. Okay. So let's take a look at what the data says. There is a lot of evidence indicating the following kind of thing. Cross-sectional studies done up to 14 years. These are studies done in the UK. And Bonta and I reviewed them in detail in 1990 in Law and Human Behavior. It's interesting why people will never have recourse to it, because this is a spoil sport kind of theory, isn't it? It's no fun, I mean. And there are cross-sectional studies indicating very little change in indices of depression, anxiety, changes in IQ, if you even want to use that kind of stable measure, and all kinds of other things. Okay, no increase, no evidence of any psychological disturbance over years being in prison. Now you can argue that a cross-sectional design isn't as good as a longitudinal design. So we have longitudinal studies that follow inmates up for a couple of years in prison. There's stuff that we did in Ontario many years ago, and the stuff done by Porporino and Zamble, and the results are the same. Okay. Then there is the crowding literature. Bonta and I produced a meta-analysis on this a number of years ago, and the argument for crowding is that that's a terrible thing to have, crowded prisons, and that will cause all kinds of stress. That will be a psychological pain of incarceration. And that will lead to upset. So we took a look at a number of studies on the effects of crowding on heart rate, GSR, blood pressure kind of things, plus institutional misconducts. And the effect size is very low. R values of around 0.10. When it comes to heart rate, a bit higher. And when you take a look at these crowding studies, there's all kinds of other factors that could account for inmates getting upset, if they do get upset, how the prison was managed, how they are treated by the staff, and all kinds of other things that may account for more of how a person behaves in prison than whether they are crowded. Okay, some argue now as a fallback position that crowding has indirect effects on behavior in prison. That's a legitimate way of thinking, but it's an interesting fallback position, because before they used to think there was a direct effect between crowded and prison disruptions, and now they're saying, well, it's coming through the back door. Depends on what your orientation is are when you do research. I'm always in favor of looking for direct effects rather than indirect effects, but there's a point to be taken. Then there are studies on correctional climate, the personality of the prison. We're going to treat the prison now as a human being, okay? Just like I was going to make a political statement, what the heck, like the U.S. Supreme Court now has said that corporations are now people. So, so prisons are now people. And there was an interesting literature on correctional climate, Rudolph Moose and the like, 20, 30 years ago. It's dropped off the map. But Claire Goggin, who is in criminology at St. Thomas University and one of my students in the past, has now taken a detailed look at correctional climate. It's an appealing hypothesis. People in, you know, if the correctional climate of the prison is bad, staff are unhappy, inmates are unhappy, hygiene is poor, the physical structure is lousy, and so on and so forth, you'd expect that correctional climate to correlate with problems in the prison. So Claire got data, it's from the 90s, it should be replicated, but it's from the 90s, on every prison in the country, sample size several thousand. And they had ratings of the correctional climate in prisons across the country by inmates and staff. Interestingly enough, the inmates and staff agreed a fair amount. There wasn't very few occasions where the inmates say, this is a lousy place, based on about 20 variables they looked at. And the staff said, this is a wonderful place. They generally agreed a fair amount. What was the data? That the correlation between a institution in our federal system being high on correctional climate and low on correctional climate, the effect size on recidivism was R equals 0.01, a 1% difference. Now, you could argue that maybe this was a biased sample. I mean, it's a whole sample in Canada, but you could argue that, well, maybe Canadian prisons are run fairly well, and so you should get this kind of result. And so it's an open question as to whether if you went into a system where they had prisons that were really bad in correctional climate and ones who were really good, you may find an effect of correctional climate. And then we have the whole issue of life course psychology. I just threw that in. The view is that prisons can cause some very deleterious effects on inmates. It goes back to the standard debate in psychology many years ago, which probably never gets taught anymore, but that is, what predicts behavior better? The traits of the individual, their personality makeup, or the situation, the immediate situation. And psychology was dominated for many years by the immediate situation kind of argument. And then traits came back in, and now we have a view in psychology that both the individual traits and personality makeup plus the situation they find themselves interact to produce behavior. But when you take a look at life course psychology, the majority of people are very consistent over a long period of time. It's a small subset that show big changes in personality over the years. At least that was my reading of a few years ago. Maybe there's some new studies that change that view. So in any case, this kind of database is some support for psychological deep freeze. Next. Implications for prison management. Well, deterrence. Any implications for it? The data is totally against it from the meta-analyses. I guess you could make prisons even harsher and harsher from a psychologist's perspective, and this is part of a chapter we're writing for the Handbook of Forensic Psychology, is that, you know, your ethical principles aren't placed in a great deal of jeopardy in working in that kind of situation. Do these two theories have some credibility? Yes, they do. There are probably exceptions in terms of the psychological deep freeze thing. Even Zammel admits it. And the schools of crime position has some implications for policy and primarily for low-risk offenders. So if, however, and if we can go to the next overhead, we are going to run prisons safely and humanely, do these theories say what you should do? They give you some guidelines, but they don't get down into the nuts and bolts. So what, to order to address this issue, we have to take a look at the what works literature. And I'm going to talk about that and how it addresses this first issue of safely and humanely. If you work in a prison, as I have and some of you have, and at times I was a manager, you, at the end of the day you say, can we get through this day without too many bad things happening? You know, can we all sort of get along? I mean, that's a naive statement because we know what some offenders can be like. We know what some staff can be like. In any case, if we're going to manage our prisons safely, we want to make sure that disruptive behavior in the prison is minimized. There are a number of assumptions we have to make. That prison misbehavior is predictable, like misconducts. Misconducts, whether they're serious with assault or of a lower level, or what we mean by misconducts. And because it's important, because misconducts should be a proxy for criminal behavior. And so when you work in a prison and you see someone who is acting out and disruptive and dangerous, you say, boy, is this just a situation peculiar to the prison, or is this guy really a bad piece of work and this is who he is? And so hopefully that you can, prison misbehavior is predictable. And in fact, the data indicates from our first meta-analysis done in 1997 that risk measures can predict misconducts. Things like the LSI is one measure, and there are others, okay? And the predictive validities are pretty good, often around 0.3. So our first meta-analysis was in 1997, and we had a one that came out in 2009, Campbell, French, and myself, looking and updating the literature as to what risk measures we have in our field that can predict misconducts and do so adequately. The HCR20 is one that does fairly well. The LSI is a good one, and there are a couple of others. Okay, so thank goodness we want to run prisons in a more safe and humane way. Risk measures predict misconducts. At least we have a start. We have measures that can be useful if we're running a prison. Secondly, are misconducts a proxy for criminal behavior? Yes, they are. Misconducts predict recidivism. Misconducts not only predict who you, whether the severity of the penalty, whether you go to segregation or not, but they predict recidivism, and it's around 0.2 or 0.3. So people who are committing misconducts in a prison are ones that will likely go on to commit more crime upon release. Well, let's carry on running it safely and humanely. Then we take a look at whether treatment programs can reduce misconducts. And there's a big meta-analysis by French and myself in CJB, Criminal Justice and Behavior, in 2006, that indicates that programs in prison that follow the principles of risk-need responsivity, you all know that theory, that reduce misconducts. In addition, there's another literature which we have attended to recently by Shelley Listwan, Joe Coons, and I in North Carolina. Now, you're all too young to remember this, but maybe an old professor here might remember that back many years ago, what were common treatment programs in prisons? They were operant conditioning programs, essentially token economies. People here know about token economies? Okay. And token economies are accountability kind of programs that follow the principles of operant conditioning. And they once were very popular. Not only were they popular with offenders, but they were popular with other kinds of clientele. And so we've reviewed the literature there in the forthcoming meta-analysis, and we find that these kinds of programs are also very effective in controlling, that sounds like an awful word, doesn't it, but controlling behavior in an institution in a pro-social way. Now, token economies are very difficult to run, and in this forthcoming meta-analysis, we also talk about the do's and don'ts of running token economies. There's a huge literature in that regard. It's fascinating stuff. In addition, there's cost-effective data that if you can prevent a misconduct that involves injury, you are saving hundreds and hundreds of dollars for an individual case. So just reducing misconduct makes it more cost-beneficial to running an institution. So clearly, if you're running safely and humanely, prison misbehaviors, misconduct should be attended to in detail. They also are very important for parole boards or transfer decisions. Okay, and I bet you if you go to cross-correctional systems, they just don't even pay attention to misconducts. I find it incredible. But if a person who is committing a lot of misconducts is one that will be pose a greater risk, not only in managing them in the institution, but also upon release. So this has important policy implications, and safely and humanely. Next. There are studies, and this is in the French and Gendreau meta-analysis, that programs that reduced misconducts the best in a prison also had lower recidivism results upon release. So this fits the proxy argument. This program reduces misconducts. Voila. We also see this kind of program also reduces recidivism. Secondly, we scored these programs based on therapeutic integrity. This is a conflict of interest. The Correctional Program Assessment Inventory 2010, it's Gendreau, Andrews, and Terrio, is the only measure in the criminal justice area that looks at the quality of treatment programs. And when we scored some of these programs that reduced misconducts in the literature, those programs that scored higher on a measure of therapeutic integrity also produced lower misconducts and lower recidivism. And finally, iatrogenic consequences. The recent study, and I'll talk about it very shortly, by Smith and Gendreau, is one that showed that you have to be very careful as to what you do with low-risk offenders, because anything you seem to do with them makes them worse, even if it is a program that is credible in the R&R way of thinking. Next. Now, protecting the public. We know that prison treatment programs reduce recidivism. Community-based programs do much better, but prison treatment programs can reduce recidivism by 15% or so, which has huge cost benefit examples. There are some issues, and I'm going to skip over real-world programs, but way back when we got into the debate of correctional treatment, there were two well-known criminologists called Lab and Whitehead. I don't know if they don't work in the area anymore. But they said, you know, when we talk about correctional treatment, you know, Andrews and Bonta and R&R and that kind of thing, well, these are specialized programs that have all the bells and whistles. What about programs that are run by social service agencies or prison staff who don't have the all of the finances and other kinds of things to make a program sort of top notch? And the simple fact is that if you have a program in a prison that can reduce recidivism by several percent, you will have big cost benefit examples. Let's take a look at I'm going to come back to this if I may, but we can take a look at this next overhead to give you an example of what I mean. This is research done in Ohio by Paula Smith and her colleagues Ed Latessa and the others. And what they did is they took a look at correctional treatment programs and measured their integrity using an abbreviated measure of the Correctional Program Assessment Inventory. Okay? And here's what they found. Programs that were low on therapeutic integrity as measured by the CPAI. The CPAI has about how many items now? 133, has a number of different domains. There was programs that scored 0 to 30, really low, increased recidivism by 19%. Programs that failed, well, 31 to 59, decreased recidivism by 5%. And those few programs that really did well on the CPAI reduced recidivism by 22%. And that is a big gain for prison-based programs done by staff who don't have tremendous university supports and a huge research grant to aid and assist them. Next overhead. This is a bit hard to see, but here we have a bunch of programs in Ohio on low-risk offenders. A whole whack of them. When this gets presented, some of the practitioners in the audience would say, where's my program on this list? So that, any case. Very few programs that targeted low-risk offenders decreased recidivism. 1%, 2%, 3%, 6%. The majority of programs increased recidivism when they targeted low-risk offenders. The average was a 4% increase. Some, for whatever reason, increased recidivism by about 30%. The message, lay off low-risk offenders. Leave them alone. Okay, next. Here is the data for high-risk offenders. It's the risk principle. High-risk offenders, the average reduction in recidivism was around 8 or 9%, some up to around 30%. Very few programs that targeted high-risk offenders increased recidivism, although a couple managed to do it. Okay, but the data is quite clear from the Ohio studies and others that you should be targeting high-risk offenders. Can we go back, if we may, please? So the effect size is around 8, 9, 10%. The greater the therapeutic integrity, as measured by the CPAI, it correlates quite highly. Often the correlation is around 0.4, 0.5. Target high-risk offenders, and the dosage level should be in a prison about 300 to 500 hours of intensive treatment time. Okay, that's not easy to do. The other study I referred to, and probably the best prison study evaluated in the literature, is the Rideau Correctional Center program done near Ottawa. And Burgo and Armstrong, Criminal Justice and Behavior 2005, that's the study. It's all summarized in here if you're interested. And that is a program that followed the principles of R&R that used 300 to 500 hours of treatment time and produced about 10 or 11, 12% reductions in recidivism for a high-risk clientele. And that 10% may not sound like a lot, but it adds up and translates into huge cost savings on the public purse. I was the chief psychologist at that institution for a number of years, but after I retired, the program got a lot better. I should note, so I'm glad you're laughing. You're too serious, damn it. And in any case, it is an excellent program. And here's the kicker. Shortly after this program generated results and got worldwide attention, it was closed by the Ontario Ministry of Correctional Services. So that's another issue that you might be interested in as criminologists, the politics of the business. If we can move on. Okay, before we get into extreme conditions of confinement, I should note we found some other interesting things. Paula Smith found that for low-risk offenders in prisons across Canada, I forgot to mention, Paula Smith's study took treatment programs across the country, sample size 5,000, every prison, federal prison in the country, except for one or two. And her results showed that programs that followed the general principles of R&R, the file data was very difficult to deal with, by and large reduced recidivism for high-risk offenders by several percent. It also reduced their misconducts. But the data was fascinating. Low-risk offenders who took programs, whether we call them following the R&R model or not, all got worse, not only in terms of their institutional misconducts, but also in terms of their recidivism. Yes, sir. I'm sorry? Okay, what do you think? Fire one out, because I'm sure you know the answer. Okay. It's a differential association model, in my view. Because in treatment programs, when you mix high risk, low risk with high risk, who often dominate these programs? The high risk offenders. They control the shot. When you go back into the dorms or the cell areas, or you go into recreation after the treatment program, who's calling the shots in an institution? The high risk offenders. So I think it is a schools of crime thing. I think the schools of crime theory has a good deal of validity in regard to low-risk offenders, but not the high-risk offenders. The high-risk offenders come into a prison, and if they're taking a course in physics, they're already at a 95% average. How are they going to get much worse? Okay, it's the low-risk offenders who get contaminated. So that is the general theoretical notion. It's still up for debate, but I think it's that kind of socialization mixing where you see low-risk offenders get contaminated. And there's some juvenile studies done many years ago. And these were not juvenile offenders, but there were group camps where they had a mix of low and high-risk kids. And if a group of four, if you had two high-risk and two low-risk, the high-risk won the day. Is that that kind of thing? That's the general thinking. Okay. Well, we started 5 minutes late. Do you want? Would you like to finish off, or maybe you've finished off? Okay, look, if you'd like to leave, go right ahead. Go right ahead. Sometimes when I listen to myself talk, that's pretty depressing, and I want to leave. Okay? There you go. This is, you're not going to like this. There is a real firestorm going on in the penology area. And that is in regard to extreme forms of incarceration, like administrative segregation, protective custody, or solitary confinement. Sounds awful. Let's follow the story. Let's take a look at the Colorado study. It just came out 2 years ago, and you have a handout. If you'd care to look at the handout, this was a study, pioneering study in a way, that looked at individuals over a year period. Some were mentally disordered, some not. Okay. Some were in solitary confinement, administrative segregation, and others were rattling around the institution like normal. And they had all kinds of measures: anxiety, hostility, psychosis, withdrawal, alienation, depression, hypersensitivity, somatization. All based on state-of-the-art measures with this detailed follow-up. Do you see a negative effect here? Okay. No matter what the setting was, for mentally disordered offenders or regular offenders, for a year follow-up, there is no increase in psychological disruption. It's almost like an importation kind of theory, eh? Database. So when this data came out, all heck broke loose, certainly amongst my American colleagues in the field, who have attacked this study in the most negative and hostile kind of ways. And what we have here is not only an ignorance of a huge swath of literature on regarding extreme conditions, but also ideology. This study is a beautiful study, huge sample size, multiple measures, all showing consistent results. And they're having trouble getting it published because some journal editors will just back away from this because they might be accused of, I'm not too sure, harboring get tough kinds of sentiments. Now, in contrast, we have a history in our field of anecdotal reports and case histories of people who are traumatized by being in prison. And this often comes from two studies, by Stuart Grassin and by Craig Haney. Grassin is a psychiatrist, and a number of years ago he interviewed about a dozen offenders at Walpole Prison in Massachusetts. And here's what's happened. He asked them, isn't this a terrible environment? Don't you have hallucinations and delusions and all kinds of psychotic kinds of symptoms? And they said, I don't think so. Sometimes I feel sort of lousy. And then only through, this is in the methodology section, by repeated questioning, was he able to draw out severe hallucinations and delusions and psychosomatic symptoms from his clientele. And the same with Haney, who did a study on about 100 inmates at one of the prisons and said that, we also had to have a number of detailed questions to bring it out of the offenders, because they were repressing these bad things so much that only through repeated questioning could you get these kinds of results. And there's no control group, no comparison group. That passes for science in this field. But it's ideologically correct, given the kind of liberal orientation all of us who work in the business. Can we go on to the next? So what we've tried to do, and it's one of the five handouts here, because I only have five handouts, because I thought, people may not be particularly interested in this topic, but you're being nice and you're showing up. So you can. This is one of the rejoinders here. Bibliotherapy for cynics. Experimental design and response bias. There are a huge number of studies looking at extreme conditions of confinement, on inmates and on non-inmates, although for brief periods of time, that don't show any of these kinds of results. But they're brief. And some of them have volunteers. Okay. And then there's this response bias literature in the sensory deprivation research. Where does the response bias comes from? It comes from the Canadian studies. Anybody here heard of Donald Hebb? Anybody? Put up your hand. An old person. Donald Hebb was one of Canada's greatest psychologists at McGill. And this is you can Google it, H-E-B-B. And this was research funded by military organizations. There's that famous movie starring Lawrence, whatever his name, it was on about brainwashing and stuff. It came out in the 50s or 60s. Help. I'm blocking on it. Yeah. And of course, after World War II and the Korean War, there was all kinds of suggestions about brainwashing techniques, and the military was very interested in it. And so these studies were conducted. First, they started in Canada, funded by the military. Hebb didn't run the studies, but his colleagues at McGill did. And what they did is they took college students and put them into dark, what they call perceptual deprivation rooms. You may be suffering from perceptual deprivation listening to me, where everything seems to be totally monotonous. But in any case, the students who were in there for a couple of hours after they got out were reporting hallucinations and delusions. And so this fit into the view that this kind of perceptual deprivation, sensory deprivation, or what we call restricted environmental stimulation environments, cause all kinds of psychological havoc. Those studies were never replicated. Okay? And why? It's because of what we call response bias. That when you have individuals in these kinds of experimental circumstances, you have to be extremely careful not to allow for response bias factors to creep into the questioning, and the people will give you the responses they want, or you want. Okay? It's a huge literature. Okay, so this was came in the McGill studies, famous stuff. Then John Zubek, that name ring a bell? That's a problem with old people. I'm in my 70s, talking about the past, just phew. In any case, bear with me. The Canadian studies. Zubek was one of Hebb's students. And he went out and established a famous laboratory on sensory deprivation using college students to see if he could replicate the kinds of dramatic findings found by Hebb, and he couldn't replicate it. Now, these were some really bizarre, well, they're all described here. I'm trying to cut it short here. These were interesting experiments. Students, in one case, spent 14 days in a coffin where their kinesthetic mobility was restricted, where their eyes and ears were occluded, so they had perceptual deprivation, and they reported very few negative effects for 14 days. You can get a college student, yes, yeah. You can get college students to do the old days, yeah. And there's a number of experiments, often for 7 days. Now here's the next step. The Canadian Penitentiary Service was interested in that. Now how do I know that? Because my father was Deputy Commissioner of Penitentiaries for a number of years. He's one of the first forensic psychiatrists in the country. And being a medical man and knowing all of this kind of research, he thought, you know, our prison cells seem like, our solitary confinement prison cells seem like a sensory deprivation environment. Could we be getting some of these dramatic effects that they seem to be finding in the McGill studies? And through the time-honored tradition of nepotism, I'm a strong believer in that because I benefited from it, I'm dying here, folks. That's a good line. And you just sit there. Goodness gracious. I'm getting like Lenny Bruce, but then you wouldn't know who Lenny Bruce was in his comedic routine, do you? For the young people, Google Lenny Bruce. Write that down, young lady. Lenny Bruce. God, help us. I'm having 4 martinis at dinner tonight, and it's all being charged to the people in this room. So in any case, so we did a number of studies at Kingston Penitentiary where inmates went into sensory deprivation for 7 days, and this random assignment study, and we did the same at Millbrook a couple of years later. And we found that, in fact, there is a sensory deprivation effect. A common effect in sensory deprivation research is to reduce your brain waves to more of a slight sleep state. And we found that reliably. We also found that the stress levels of inmates got a bit lower when they into a quiet environment. But why wouldn't it? Now, before this all sounds so callous, back in those days, there's a tradition amongst researchers to apply the treatment to yourself. So I also spent 7 days in sensory deprivation. And you just sort of, you have all kinds of great ideas to save the world, to get yourself fit and do push-ups, but you just sort of sit there and, you know, nothing much happens, and then you leave. Okay. And so there are a number of sensory deprivation studies done by the Canadian Penitentiary Service to see what happened. Now, subsequently, after that, there were a number of studies done on people who weren't volunteers, looking at people who were sent to sensory deprivation or solitary as a punishment. By Peter Sudfeld, a famous psychologist, UBC, did some studies. Ivan Zinger also did a study with Don Andrews. And they all found very few, take care of yourself, negative effects of being in solitary confinement for a couple of months or more. Okay, so we have these applied studies, which are never referenced by the Haneys and Grassians, showing no or very few deleterious effects of being in solitary confinement. Why is this the case? This is the case because many offenders have experienced with these kinds of conditions. Why would you expect them to become babbling fools on average as a result of being in this kind of environment? Completely missing in any discussion of this, because that would mean that people in the area would have to read widely, I'm sorry to be so cynical about it, is that there's a huge amount of research in the perceptual adaptation area, a million miles divorced from this, indicating that when people get in different environments, their powers of perceptual adaptation to different stimuli is profound. It's very powerful. Okay, this is in perceptual psychology. Okay, then no one wants to read that literature. It's a tough literature to read. And also, it probably fits in with a behavioral deep freeze. Let's carry on to the next overhead. Now, some of you will be saying, look, This presenter, i.e. myself, is getting a little carried away and should settle down and take my medication, which is probably a good advice. Is the Colorado study the final word? No, it isn't. But people are reacting like it is. The simple fact is that it could be that the Colorado study reflects sampling error. Now, no one here does meta-analysis, but one of the things we learn from doing meta-analysis is that many diverging results are simply sampling error. In actual fact, in the social sciences, most introductions go on and on, but he said this, I said that, you didn't say that, and likely it's just a sampling error. Okay, and that's what you learn when you do meta-analysis. And it could be that another study done in another jurisdiction may show exactly the same results or similar results to Colorado. It may show worse results, and I'll tell you the reason why. Secondly, before we start getting all excited and jumping up and down and having our blood pressure raised by throwing buns at each other as to what is this and what's going on in sensory deprivation, is we have to know meta-analysis. And we won't be able to make solid policy, and we generate a number of studies that can all be put together and do a meta-analytic inquiry. And what surprises me, what saddens me, is that there is tons of data in prisons across this country and in the United States whereby you could probably, if the files were good enough, of course that's a dubious proposition, could go back and see if you could in many other prisons and other jurisdictions get a similar result to the Colorado study. So knowledge accumulation. Next. Yes, the whole thing. Thank you so much. The other thing is that in this gefuffus, in the literature, this is terrible, this is awful, no one says what they should do about it. So Yvette and I stepped into the breach and wrote an article, which is there, on what you might want to do. This is the kind of thing, because I'm an applied person, okay? I'm a program evaluation person. We should be helping agencies and individuals in need. Our responsibility as professionals is to say what you might want to do based on the scientific literature. And don't just sit there. As Disraeli said, it's easier to be critical than correct. So we have a number of prescriptions which we'll be writing about in the near future. First of all, there are some people, if they have to go into a solitary confinement-like environment, and particularly for long periods of time, is divert inmates who cannot cope. There has to be, again, a great deal of data in institutions already where you could find out what inmates did not cope with solitary confinement and what were their distinguishing characteristics. We've had a tough time finding out who can, by the way, tolerate with sensory deprivation amongst non-offenders. Are these people who are high on stimulation seeking? Who knows? Are they brighter, less bright, more criminal, less criminal? We don't know. But that is one agenda. Secondly, we should screen out mentally disordered offenders to make sure that they don't get into these environments. Now, the interesting sidebar to this is that since criminologists, sorry about this, know nothing about or very little about human behavior, they've got the argument backwards. They keep saying if a mentally disordered offender goes into a solitary environment, that is terrible. Their hallucinations and delusions will increase. One of the principles of the risk-need responsivity theory, particularly specific responsivity, says that you have to be concerned with individual differences. An offender who has a mentally disordered background, what kind of environment do they like the best? Stable, quiet, don't have to interact with anybody. In matter of fact, one of the problems we have is that they often, or sometimes, engineer themselves into a sensory deprivation cellular environment. Okay? So, no wonder, at least in the Colorado study, they didn't find any negative or iatrogenic consequences of mentally disordered offenders in a quiet, solitary, administrative segregation environment. Okay? That, to them, was not a bad place to do time. And Yvette has found from her survey and research for CSC that a lot of offenders think that's not a bad place to do time. And even some correctional officers say, geez, the way this prison is one, I wouldn't mind doing my time there as well. Secondly, or thirdly, we should have early intervention with high-risk inmates because a meaningful percentage of people who get into administrative segregation or solitary confinement are individuals who are pardon the language, the shit disturbers in an institution. But you can identify them with risk measures. That's the whole point of what I talked about half an hour ago, about identifying them with risk measures, and then the French and Gendreau meta-analysis showing that treatment programs can reduce misconducts. So immediately, institutions should be assessing who's going to be a high-risk inmate in the institution, and then trying to get them into programs so that they'll become a little more sociable and socializing in a proper way and not get into solitary. And the elephant in the phone booth, here's what it is, and people ignore it. And I don't know how they can't ignore it, because I'm not too sure why. What do you think when inmates overreact in prison or overreact in solitary confinement, what do you think the reason is? What do you think a major reason might be? It's so straightforward, so simple an answer, but it just goes like a 100 mile an hour fastball on the outside corner. What is the elephant in the phone booth? Precisely. If you treat people in any organization inconsistently, take away their any powers of control over their environment, denigrate people, humiliate people, just generally crap on them, what are you going to get? A strong reaction. I mean, just think, you're in an academic setting here. And what if all of a sudden the administration changed the rules in midstream about what it took to graduate? What if they decided to change your grades from a 75 to a 55 because they just felt that was a good idea? What if your advisor, I'm talking to you students, told you that you were the stupidest thing they'd ever seen and the last thing they want to do is continue to supervise you? All those things. How would you feel? What if they raised your tuition? Oops, sensitive topic here in Quebec. By another $1,000. Would you be upset? Sure you would be. And yet you're in a university environment which, on the surface, should be pretty pleasant. When we started this debate with Michael Jackson, the famous lawyer in Canada from Vancouver back in the 70s, and this is one of our articles, Solitary Confinement Isn't Cruel and Unusual Punishment, People Are, something like that, which is a bit too provocative a title, but Michael Jackson, who's one of the leaders, and good for him, in talking about the pernicious effects of prison on life, said, you know, these maximum security environments, solitary confinement, terrible, terrible. It produces all kinds of negative reactions. And then he admitted in print, thank goodness, you know, some of my clients got transferred to Millhaven Institution when it was one of the fanciest Club Med kinds of prisons you'd ever want to go. And they're still complaining. Okay. So importation model has a lot to say about it. Now, this isn't an argument for using solitary confinement. There are all kinds of other ways people can, as it were, be controlled in institutions so they're not bashing each other left and right and threatening staff. Through cognitive behavioral programs, through token economy programs if they're run properly. So you don't have to rely on these kinds of draconian kinds of things in terms of the way they're held. But in all cases, what I'd like to see is a research agenda where someone would just monitor how the offenders treat each other and how the staff treat offenders. And I think you'll find that that explains a great amount of variance in terms of how people react in prison. Is there another overhead? Oh, my goodness. No. Ah, relief. That's just like you can now escape the aversive environment. That's one of the principles of effective...